and welcome to this episode of CNS Dialogues for Sustainable Development, which is a special CNS series presenting thought-provoking and insightful interviews from leaders to accelerate progress towards achieving the Sustainable Development Goals by 2030, and ending AIDS by 2030 is one such goal. And are we on track? Well, let us hear from our special guest on site from the 12th National Conference of the AIDS Society of India being held in Chennai. This episode of CNS Dialogues for Sustainable Development features Dr. Dilip Mathai, Vice President of AIDS Society of India and recipient of Lifetime Achievement Award at ASICON 2019 in recognition of his outstanding contribution to medical teaching for an infectious disease practice. Dr. Mathai dons many hats and all with a lot of aplomb. He is Professor of Medicine and Adult Infectious Diseases at Apollo Institute of Medical Sciences and Research, Hyderabad. He is also Dean of two colleges, Apollo Hospitals Education and Research Foundation, Hyderabad, as well as the Chittoor campus. And he has worked for several years at India's very famous Christian Medical College, Vellore, what we commonly call, is known as CMC. Welcome, Dr. Mathai.
Thank you.
Dr. Mathai, where are we in terms of HIV treatment and prevention right now, and what can we do better?
In India has adopted or taken the challenge of achieving the 90-90-90 by 2020. I am not saying that we are very far off from the target, but we are close to it. We still have a whole year left, and people are beginning to understand what 90-90-90 would mean to the HIV world as well as to the general population. So more people have been involved, have been roped in to help us achieve this target. The first 90, we would say, is know your status. Now, everybody has a fear. Why is there a fear to know my status, whether I got diabetes or hypertension? No problem. But if I am to know that I have got HIV, I am a little worried, nervous. What would my family think about me? Would there be any stigma? Would there be any discrimination? Can I continue to stay with my family? Will I have that respect from my family? So it's best that I don't know. Neither do I want to, you know, at the same, you know, decrease my risk or decrease my harm. In other words, if I am a drug user, I would continue to use it, enjoy the pleasure of not knowing whether I am positive. And but at the same time, that altruistic feeling has to come that I may be positive, my partner does not know, but it is time that I began to check myself. So I think there has to be a wholesome change amongst the general population, particularly the high-risk group, particularly the IV drug users, particularly the amongst the commercial sex workers and the truckers who are the bridge population, and of course now the adolescent youth who needs to understand, you know, whether they are positive or negative. At the same time, there is so many methods available to prevent it. So if I know I am negative, I would be very happy. And if I know that I can continue to be negative, I would still be active. So we've got efforts to prevent. We've got the condom usage, of course. We've got the PrEP, pre-exposure prophylaxis. And we have got centers where we can go by and check our status. You know, only we need to know the result, but how we handle the result is something, you know, which we have to educate the population on that. The second 90 is those who are positive must be on treatment. So if 90% of those who know that they are positive take the treatment, which is very effective, then we've got a winning strategy, because the winning strategy tells me that once I test and I treat, my viral loads will come down. And when it does come down, let's say in 48 weeks or so, then the risk of transmission is very low.
Yes.
So having achieved, if 90% of us who have been diagnosed or detected to be HIV positive get themselves on treatment, then either the chances of transmission is very low as such. More importantly, this is a chronic illness.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
This is an illness that for which you have to take medicine throughout your life. An equivalent of this disease, diabetes, hypertension. You have to take the medicines throughout your life. However, diabetes and hypertension are a little more forgiving.
Yes.
If you if you miss a tablet, if you don't take a tablet in the last 7 days, okay, your diabetes is not really going to go out of control. But in the case of HIV, let's say you miss it and you're not adherent to the regimen, then if you miss a dose, say, twice in a week, we call you not so adherent. For all practical purposes, any person who has missed a dose in the last 7 days is considered to be non-adherent. We don't have the same classification system for diabetes or hypertension.
Very right.
So, but here, if you do not take the tablets regularly and keep the virus checked, or don't allow it to rebound, you know, you will have a good sustained virological response, which is equivalent to 90% of the people being adherent. So you see now early detection, early treatment, and continued adherence to the therapy. Let's say 90-90-90. But mathematically, if you look at it, even if you achieve 90-90-90, technically 75% of the population, we have almost controlled. And add to that zero transmission. If you add to that zero transmission, then you're on the winning side of beating the epidemic. Do I foresee? Yes, 2030, I would continue to be practicing medicine.
Yes, of course.
I think I will live to see the stage when we achieve close to 100. But my worry still remains with so many antiviral drugs that are available and lack of understanding of their effectiveness, and people not knowledgeable about these 25 drugs and the various combinations that are required, will I have a problem of multi-drug resistance? I hope not. We're trying to educate as many people as possible. Even though I am a specialist in infectious disease, I restrict myself to first line therapy. If I do want to start on second line therapy or the third line therapy, I always look at mutational studies, phenotypic studies, genotypic studies. Even after the results come, I put down my thoughts and I check with another person to find out, is this okay? Is this okay? Because at my level, this patient has lost one chance of a life-sustaining ability, of an assured longevity. But for some reason, a relapse, a kind of rebound has occurred. I don't want to make the second error. That is why I would always be very careful when I switch patients, when I change drug regimen, and even at my level of experience and expertise, I go at it very, very careful. So I don't want the general physicians to just, you know, randomly choose, like they choose their color of their dress or the shoes that they have to wear or the belt that they have to wear for the day. Okay, today I will use. This was the story in TB. And that was why we are having, even though TB treatment is only 6 months and 9 months, we created havoc.
Yes, right.
This is the same story with bacterial resistance to antibiotics.
Yes.
We created havoc. I don't say the entire the reason is by the physicians. There are some other factors as well, environmental hygiene and sanitation and use of antibiotics in the cattle and for piggery industry, for the
ivories,
bees, for honey industry, or for the aquaculture. That is separate. But medical people should know when to use antibiotics. And there has to be a rational use of antibiotics. So you see, it's all boils down to education, education, education. People have to understand that these weapons which we use to treat bacteria, TB, viruses, now fungus, have to be understood properly. It is not that one size suits all. And it is not, and remember, and also combination of drugs. Today, with several transformations of life lengthening, let's say medical devices or operations, procedures or opportunities, you have got other diseases coming in. Like for example, you do not know your microbiome. You do not. There, we know the entire gut is full of organisms. 10 to the power of 12 or 10 to the power of 14 organisms out there. Some of them are, or most of them are good guys who help you. We have not studied, but we think that maintaining the milieu would prevent havoc in the intestinal system, in the food absorption, in the mutations of the rapidly multiplying cells of the GI tract. All cells are multiplying. You apply a mutant to that, anything that can change the chromosome can result in an abnormal proliferation of the mutant cell. We don't know what this mutant cell is capable of doing, suppressing or causing proliferation. So I think chemicals, all antibiotics, antivirals or chemicals should be used to the minimum, and of course to be used when there is a real reason. Otherwise, I'm a grandfather now. Perhaps my grandson may get along, but not his children. And the number of drugs that really needs to come out in order to beat the resistance profile that we see, you know, would be far more toxic, I think, for the use. But perhaps the world and science will improve, and you'll come to a lesser and lesser toxic drug. During this conference, I was not so confident, but I heard about bacteriophages, but they're beginning to use it for the treatment of drug-resistant TB.
Yes.
Or they've got a profile that is suitable for the treatment of drug-resistant. So perhaps newer technologies will evolve. Men think, you know, very wild and widely, and the world out there has the answers to the problems that we face. But how long would it take? How many people's lives would be lost before we really discover something? So is that a very high price to pay? Yes. The treatment is cheaper by better education. That's what my approach would
be. Right. But till we wait for the new drugs and diagnostics to come, I think we need to make the best use of what is
whatever
existing,
whatever
is
best
available.
Best and maximum.
Yes, yes.
You know, and reaching, you're talking about 7 billion plus population.
Yes, yes.
And we are not talking about a few thousands or 10,000 people who are, or a few millions.
Right.
You know, we need to reach out and preserve what we have.
And again, you are an expert in infectious diseases, and somewhere down the line, are we losing the fight to AIDS? Are we losing the fight to tuberculosis? Because tuberculosis still is one of the biggest.
You know, that's a very good question. Are we losing the fight to tuberculosis? My quick and ready answer will be no. Because what we are looking at is we have made several errors. One is control. Second one is in the, we call it elimination of TB. Third one is the eradication of TB. Now let's look at control. What do we mean by control? Have we decreased the prevalence of TB?
Yes.
Have we decreased the incidence of TB? My answer to that is no. Why have we not decreased? So when the control program is yes. not doing its job well, then you cannot go on to the next step
yes,
of elimination
okay.
and eradication. I am not blaming the government for the control program, though the word C exists in the revised national and revised national tuberculosis control program. It's a very good treatment program. And government and or we physicians are using the drugs prescribed or provided to us by the government in the right way. But still, we have to get these patients on treatment, make sure that they have eliminated, make sure that the TB has been, there are no more TB germs in that person that is capable of transmitting. But that is where we are failing. Many reasons. Either the TB drugs help improve them and they feel that they have improved and they stop. Perhaps some side effects, perhaps inability to get the medicine. Those are all things that we can overcome, provided we have got almost door to door or individual to individual contact. We have to send the Army, Navy and the Air Force to treat all patients who have got TB. If we have such an approach, and then the second part is search and destroy. Look for people who have not manifested themselves with florid symptoms of TB. Door to door search, look at them, questionnaire. It is not common. Everybody talks about air pollution and therefore respiratory symptoms are more common. Yes, it may be adding to the whole turmoil of increased prevalence of TB. Smoking, pollutants, close living, all these air transmission occurs, organism transmission occurs, illiteracy, poverty of the people, malnutrition, all these would take its toll. In other words, the germ AFP that gets into the system gets a foothold for it to multiply. Take for example, transmission characteristics. If I acquire AFP today, yes, within a matter, sometimes 10%, 90% of them, because my immune system is good, would eliminate it. Remainder, it gets into the system remains within the body. Even in the former case, where I say that it's eliminated, it is dormant somewhere in my system. My tuberculin is positive.
Yes.
I know that my antigen or MTB is somewhere in my body. As age advances, perhaps my immunological surveillance would be a little lower and I may come out with the TB. But now, with people who are, let's say, malnutrition is also a form of poor immune status.
Yes.
And then you are burdened or bludgeoned with a large amount of organism, inoculum, either in a crowded bus system or in the slum area or in a household. And also people who have got respiratory illnesses as a result of pollutants, etc., the capacity or the ability to transmit from one to the other is more because it is aerosol borne. Secondly, your immune status is poor. Thirdly, ignorance. Even though I might have this cough, I would think it as probably related to the pollutants, and I do not seek assistance early. Classical definition for medical students is anybody who presents with 2 weeks of cough with sputum should have a sputum test for AFP. But these people come to us very late, 45 days, 55 days late, and how many other people they would have infected. So the answer to your question is, are we losing the war? Well, we have to start fighting the war. Before we have not done this kind of an search and destroy approach. So we are part of a committee group called Committee or a concern for the elimination of TB in India. When we say elimination, is that we are bringing it down to a number, 90 per 100,000, which is, you know, a good control system than our present rate of 155 and 160 per 100,000 population. So unless everybody cooperates, employers, employers of organizations, public sector, private sector, the transport sector, it has to be multi-sectoral an approach. And then we can say in a year or two, if everybody participates, that the war has begun and we will see good dividends as such. Then comes the stage of elimination. Once people who are having active TB, you detect them, you treat them, where is the question of transmission? So then we get into that elimination very soon. And really, battles, these are all the battles, but the war will really be won when we eliminate TB in a large number of our population. So I'm very hopeful. Mm-hmm. The date for me is 2030 again. Mm-hmm. Prime Minister Ji has said 2025.
Yes,
we try, we shoot for it.
And treating TB is of course important so that they don't spread infection, and also preventing latent TB from getting into active TB. So
yeah.
Targeting the latent TB.
Yeah. See, like I said, I may be having
TB.
Yes,
you said that, yeah.
I don't know about the rest of the world,
right.
But I know that I have a latent TB. But I'm okay. I'm not on any immunosuppressing drugs. I'm not having any immunosuppressing virus. And the chance of me breaking out as my immunity wanes with advancing age, all of these factors are out there. But there is nothing so potent as an immunosuppressant such as other like HIV.
Yes, right. Yeah. So
nothing so potent as an immunosuppressant like if you've got this malnutrition, you've got chronic renal failure, you've taken immunosuppressing drugs in cancers and other hematological diseases. So therefore, the chances of my latent TB breaking out into a florid TB would be higher than the general population who carries this latent TB. So thoughts are there, why not we give such patients with latent tuberculosis with a propensity or likelihood of breaking out into active TB, why don't we consider a prophylactic therapy? And the prophylactic therapy, fortunately or unfortunately, is part of the TB treatment armamentarium, which is INH is the prophylactic treatment. If it was some other drug A, B and C, which is not part of the treatment profile, then it is okay. Since INH prophylactic treatment or the drug INH is part of the TB treatment, we are taught rule out active TB. After you rule out active TB only, you consider latent TB. Now you give me, I don't have active TB, INH, I got latent TB. These organisms, I do not know whether it would be susceptible to this INH. If by any chance it is susceptible, well and good. If not, then I have imposed INH on a TB which is not rapidly multiplying.
Yes.
When it is not rapidly multiplying, it has got its own resources to become resistant in some form because of the sub-inhibitory levels and only single drug monotherapy. So I'm utilizing a very valuable drug in the four drug combination. So therefore physicians are a little reluctant. Secondly, these people are still not going to be regular.
That is the big
once
point.
If they're not going to be regular again,
that
becomes a problem.
Right.
Third is they are healthy and they're looking at it as why should I take you know, it's very difficult to convince them that they've got TB. So the prophylactic INH prophylactic therapy has not come into great vogue, though people are recommending that we take it for the HIV population. South Africa is doing well, But yes. I do not know about the resistance problems that it will create. When you're talking about 2.71 million or 2.17 million people with HIV.
Yes, and you're very right that even South Africa may be doing well in the case of people living with HIV. They have rolled out IPT in a big way. But how many are completing the treatment, as you said, and how means that is also an important part to look into.
Completing the treatment
six, for 6 months. That the
six months is very. It's when I was running my TB clinic in at CMC Vellore, with all my support systems. I would, and it was a 9 month therapy. Only 60% were complete.
Just imagine.
Now with several, two decades have passed since my, since those days. People are becoming aware, doctors are becoming more aware, and they're insisting that they complete the treatment. Perhaps now I would go to the extent of saying in the government program, almost 93% are completing. In the private area, I do not know how many, but we are thinking that they are more educated and they are more responsive to information, or they are able to check, and they would be completing their therapy. Anyway, it would be around 90% completing the full-fledged.
Also, in people living with HIV, I'm talking of people.
Regular,
yes, this is about the general disease.
Regular population.
In case of people living with HIV who are
with
on
HIV,
TPT,
with
who
HIV,
are on TB preventive treatment.
HIV has got so many co-infections.
Right.
TB is the most common and the most
lethal,
debilitating one.
Yes.
In them, their focus is on HIV. TB is not the focus for the patient, because he has got other things to handle.
Yes.
He has to handle his nutritional problem, he has to handle his associated problems of alcohol, smoking, and then on top of it, you tell him that he has
got TB.
Medicine. And top of it, you tell him that it's a combination of four medicines, and you ask him to take the tablets in the, you know, the single tablets as such. His focus is on TB. And the moment he gets any side effect, nausea, vomiting, he will stop the TB treatment. And then he will restart it. And now government has brought both HIV and TB under the same umbrella. So the person who follows him up makes sure that they take the TB treatment as well as the HIV treatment. I think the drugs and the associated side effects. Now they brought out this long-acting rifapentin.
Yes.
Both as an injection or even as an oral form.
Right.
So that should also help, because the side effects may be lesser. Because side effects can be a result of toxicity or hypersensitivity, or maybe an immune complex phenomenon, or just an idiosyncratic reaction. So stimulating the P450 enzyme systems by rifampicin affects, you know, the metabolism of the other drugs. So I think a greater effort has to be made by the healthcare professions as such. Not just the doctor alone, just prescribes.
Yes, right. The entire thing. Now with more and more people, thanks to new treatments and good treatment, people with HIV, they are leading longer lives. So with the age bar being increased, that must be bringing other problems, other age-related comorbidities.
Now, we're talking with reference to the HIV.
Yes, with reference to HIV, yes.
HIV is just a virus. But what happens is the presence of the virus makes the body want to fight against it. In order to fight against it, they've got the cells, let us say CD4 cells. Then they've got these humoral antibodies. But now people are realizing that you need cytokines, pro-inflammation. These cytokines are also acting against, or are also being produced in response to the HIV. So, because they're all mounting up an attack on the virus. Unfortunately, this pro-inflammatory or this inflammatory substances like cytokines and interleukins, etc., they take its toll on the endothelial cells of the capillaries. The endothelial, if you ask me, which everybody says their cell is important. If you sell the hospital gastroenterologist, they will sell the hepatocytes are important. Cardiologists will say myocytes are important, that is the cells of the heart. But most, in my opinion, the most important cells are those cells lining the capillaries, lining the blood vessels, which takes the blood pumped from the heart to my little toe or to my finger. These capillaries react to inflammation. When these capillaries, when these endothelial cells react to this inflammation, they produce active molecules of substances which can also damage the surface of the blood vessel, which is the arteries, as well as cause the circulating elements of the blood, which is platelets, to adhere to these damaged areas and cause some kind of an obstruction, which results in your stroke, in your myocardial infarction, or in your peripheral gangrene. Now what about kidneys? Kidneys are also fed with blood. Kidneys have also got glomerulus, which is capillaries. They could also have effects, changes. So if the arterial supply system is affected, they could also have changes. Now we look at the nerves, or you look at the associated dropout of cells in the brain, which we call as dementia. We do not know the cause of dementia. That is neuronal dropout, apoptosis, cell death, programmed cell death. I do not know what exactly is happening out there. But fundamentally, it has to be involved with some amount of nutrition or nutrition in order to provide for the metabolism of the cells. Perhaps it is vascular, perhaps it is an infective agent, perhaps they are even talking about pollution, which is causing or hampering or affecting this dementia. So frequent forgetfulness, okay. Then age-related waning of the cells. Now in HIV, in the elderly, partly rising age, plus the effect of the virus, perhaps has its toll on premature death of these brain cells. Now, so you've lost your heart, you've got your blood vessels affected, your kidney, then your brain. Liver by itself doesn't age. Kidney ages. So you can have one. What I mean by kidney aging is the functions of the kidney would drop with age. In other words, the glomerular functions, its ability to segregate the waste, would decrease. Why? Because the number of nephrons drop. And then on top of it, you've got the added effects of certain drugs that you give these patients. When you get these drugs given to these patients, the dropout or the kidney effect will be more. In other words, today kidney can be protected by renal protection methods and renal prevention methods. There are strategies. If you've got hypertension, control it. If you've got a diarrhea, take more fluids and ensure that the kidney is able to function. So people, everybody says running is good for your heart, exercise is good. How is exercise good? They say it's probably the increased vagal tone, the increase in the vagal activity, whether by yoga or by running, etc., decreases the heart rate, allows the heart to function more regulated, allows these endothelial cells to, you know, manage its affairs better, doesn't have to be unstable, and then you control the eating, your metabolism, your well-being, your levels of stress, is so-called stress. Does stress cause an inflammation? I'm not too sure, but people say it does. So all these are added factors in an otherwise normally aging population. Yes. So when we say, can we age gracefully? Yes, you could, without having any one of these so-called diseases which can accelerate or impact the process of natural aging.
So easier said than done, yes, we can. Doctor, one thing which strikes me very often in India, why is there almost, I find, very little emphasis on adult vaccination? I know it means vaccination, that word we associate with children, and rightly so. I have nothing, but there is, even in the medical fraternity, I find that they will.
The part, yes, there are, I do agree with you that there are adult vaccinations, and these vaccines are not being taken regularly or
seriously,
by the elderly population. Yes. Let's say I am now 65 plus. There are, if you look at the age pyramid in our country, there must be about 60 million of us above this age group of 65, which means about 10 to 13% of our population. Are we neglecting them, or the children are they neglecting their parents? Or this aging population, are they accepting that I finished my innings,
now I
relax in my pavilion as such? Or perhaps they have not been told, they have not been emphasized, or the adult physicians are busy being busy treating patients rather than preventing or promoting health. It is only literature or newspapers or articles which tell them how to live their life in terms of, you know, protecting your life and preventing illness and promoting good health and etc. But physicians as such, how often do they check their blood pressure? Can they, should they go to their lab, or should they go to their clinic, or should they have any equipment at home? Will they buy an equipment at home to check the blood pressure? Now, because stroke occurs in the elderly, will they check home monitoring? Will they do blood sugar checking once in a way, once in 3 months, once in 6 months, or five times in a year? What do we advise them? We advise them, keep your physical activity high, don't fall. Now, bone health is important. They don't look at that bone health. Over all these years, after retirement, they begin to look at bone health, hearing, vision, all of which would handicap them, would affect their lives. They were focusing on that. They are not focusing on infectious disease, which can be prevented by immunization, namely influenza out there in the country. Second one, pneumonia, pneumococcal pneumonia out there. Third one is, I know I've had chicken pox. I know I can break down into herpes zoster or shingles, but use of this vaccine, herpes zoster vaccine, can prevent. Well, I shave every day. Do I take tetanus shot? I'm hoping that my blades do not contain any Clostridium tetani. My grandson comes home, he is immunized against whooping cough and diphtheria. But the elderly, my childhood immunization is certainly, I don't think it is lasting at the age of 40, at this age. Do I need a booster? So tetanus, diphtheria, pertussis, and then, then these are all, I know I went to Africa. You are also going to Africa. Whether you are going to take? Yes, Government of India mandates that you take yellow fever. I am a healthcare worker. I've taken hepatitis B. Now, how many of us are even stating that adult vaccination, human papilloma virus, is an adult vaccination? Adolescents. You define what is adult. Anything more than the pediatric age group is adult. Adolescent. I would recommend human papilloma virus vaccine at the age of 18, before they begin. If you believe that the sexual activity begins only after marriage, after 18, then yes, before marriage you should give. But if it is earlier, perhaps you have to start it even at a younger age. Travel vaccines everybody takes, because like typhoid, the chemoprophylaxis for malaria, etc. They take, why? Because they are spending money for a leisure.
Yes.
And they don't mind spending ₹1,000 more for prophylaxis. But sitting in my home, I'm okay, I think I'm healthy, I'm not traveling. Why should I spend a few thousands in order to prevent this? I won't get, is the answer. So my wife is a pediatrician. She makes her kids into a pincushion. We adult physician, we do not participate in making people give up smoking. Respiratory physicians do. General physicians, no. General practitioners, no. So smoking, who are? Now we know vasectomy is the best way to go forward rather than tubectomy. They are now looking at male sterilizant, which will as an oral as a contraceptive. So for 5 years you don't have to take, or 10 years. Why not vasectomy? They will not do that. Who promotes it? Asthma is said to be a reversible lung disease. Who ensures that my lung capacity is normal? I mean, I go for the treatment of asthma, but who ensures that you've got the normal lung capacity of a person who does not have asthma? Who looks at bone health? Who looks at, today we know breast cancers can be, if detected early, can be treated. Which physician? Let me say, is it gynecologist, or is it a surgeon, or a general physician who looks at women and says that, have you had your annual pap smear, or have you had your mammogram? Okay, and if the mammogram, and who is using high quality mammogram? Mammogram is nothing but an x-ray of the soft tissue of the breast. And if you do not have a high discriminatory or high resolution mammogram, you're bound to make errors. There is no tumor marker for breast cancer. Well, you got the genetic marker which says BRAC1, etc. You can't ask people to go and screen for BRAC1. If they have, then they should still go on to take mammograms more frequently. I don't know of a gene that will tell me whether one should stop smoking or not. Everybody is taking a chance that I do not have the gene which, or a mutant gene that will continue to smoke. So answer to this is, prevention is has to come from, from within them. Somebody has to advise them, tickle their conscience a little bit, and then they read up about it, perhaps then they go in for immunization. So adult immunization, influenza, we say it's a must, pneumococcus, respiratory, well, hepatitis B if you are a healthcare worker, human papilloma virus if you are an adolescent, and then you go in for herpes zoster above the age of 65, tetanus after each injury or after a road traffic accident is what they do. But no primary immunization, no secondary booster doses have been recommended for tetanus, diphtheria and pertussis whenever there is an epidemic. So these constitute the, and some of these travel vaccines. Adult vaccines for diarrhea, not, rotavirus, we don't suggest. Now there are certain vaccines that are coming for enterotoxigenic producing E. coli. Perhaps at that time people may look at it, it could be devastating, and perhaps people still eat street food, but do they take a vaccine against typhoid? So it is attached to, look, and it's all that we can teach is it is harmless and it is a cost effective way of minimizing the acquisition of such illnesses.
Right, that's very true. I try to do as much as I can at my level. Thank you. Your message for the World AIDS Day. It may be a cliched question, but World AIDS Day is so close by. So
I like the theme of this conference, collaborate and
consolidate
then
and conquer.
And if you are able to collaborate with a large number of people, now for the World AIDS Day, we are planning to collaborate with the youth.
Okay.
I'm not, go out and speak to the children about what it means of the virus that we faced 30 years ago. You guys have got an opportunity because the world knows that this virus is transmitted by the through sexual contact, at least 95 to 97%. When 30 years ago we didn't know, there may be other viruses lurking around. So my thing, my suggestion to you is be aware of illnesses that are around you, not just HIV, but several other infectious diseases around you. So I can't just tell you don't smoke, don't drink alcohol, or don't have extramarital or abundant multiple partners as such. I mean, these are things that you should already know, but be aware. It would be my message for the World AIDS Day.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions which have come up?
There are two. Sir, there is one question and probably you have answered, but still I will just read it out, and one is a clarification thing. The question is, today in this era of specialization, so we need to work together on TB, latent TB, diabetes, tobacco, HIV, malnutrition, alcohol, etc. as they are so linked, how to promote collaboration between different medical specialities, between health and non-health sectors, how to encourage students in this era of specialization?
Are you referring to specialization in medicine and in the various aspects?
So this has,
yes, I think.
Our person has not mentioned this, but probably yes.
Like, now specialization in medicine, initially when the subject of medicine was taught, we all worked under the principle of apprenticeship. You worked under a doctor, you learned cardiology, you learned surgery, you learned gynecology, etc., apprenticeship. Then the world evolved into so-called discipline or organ-based, which is cardiology, heart, lung, liver, etc. So now, but they had to have some kind of a discipline. So when did discipline come in? Like, for example, is it a medical specialty or is it a surgical specialty? So if you look at the evolution, it is medical specialty and a surgical specialty. So I am not a surgeon, so I will keep the surgical specialty aside. But when you look at the discipline of medicine, again, it has got certain organs, heart, lung, kidney, etc. Infectious disease doesn't have a discipline like this. Geriatrics is age-related. Infectious disease is predominantly medical, but can also get into surgical. So when we talk about specialization, it is good because people are able to focus more in the territory of their organ systems, more in the territory of their tissue and their cells. When I look at infectious disease, what is the specialty? Infectious disease specialist knows a little more on drugs, antibiotics, pharmacodynamics, pharmacokinetics, drug toxicity, and how it affects them. Microbiologist would know about the bugs more than what the infectious disease more than what the general physician knows. If you ask the radiologist can only tell you, so there is a contour or an organ or a shape of an organ which is beyond the limits of that particular organ. This may be an expansion of that organ, or it may be an accumulation of something else which is mimicking that. But they do not know what is accumulating. They do not know which. They can tell you this organ is expanding, but why is it expanding? They cannot tell you. Similarly, the cardiologist will know the physiology very well, and they will know how to protect their myocytes. The nephrologist will know how to protect their kidney and the glomerulus, etc. but it's the general physician that is required to put all these organ systems together. And that is why I say the discipline of general medicine or internal medicine is probably the way to go forward with some amount of specialization to care for people who have got illnesses or disorders of the major organ system. So that is how I view specialization. So I tell my people, focus on internal medicine, be a good internal medicine person first, then you go into your various specialties. And that is how the medical education and postgraduate education is being focused in India as such.
And sir, there is a small clarification. A person has congratulated you for the Lifetime Achievement Award and says 60% therapy completion rate you mentioned in CMC Vellore when you were there. Is it for active disease or latent TB?
For active TB. It is for active TB.
Okay, many thanks, Dr. Mathai. Friends, in this episode of CNS Dialogues, we were listening to Dr. Dilip Mathai, a well-known authority in the field of infectious diseases and a range of other things. Antimicrobial resistance also, he has worked a lot on that. On site from the 12th National Conference of the AIDS Society of India taking place in Chennai. Thanks, and stay tuned for the next episode. Thank you very much.
Thank you.